Hey, hello guys, welcome back to the channel Software Brains. Hope you all are doing good and learning well. If you are new to the channel and haven't subscribed yet, please do subscribe and support us. In this channel, you would find very important and useful videos for learning programming, coding problems for competitive exams, tech news, various job notifications, and interview preparation videos. And you would also find software life and cultural videos. So without wasting time, let's dive into the video. In this video, we will discuss five basic programming important questions that everyone should know. Every individual who is starting his journey to learn programming would definitely start with these five questions, and these five questions would definitely build a strong foundation so that you could enhance yourself in learning more and more problems. After watching this video, you would also find various next level programming questions in our channel. So after watching this video, you could also check out our playlist Most Important Coding Problems. That would be very useful if you are planning to prepare for your interviews or exams or various job notifications. So let's see what are these questions. So the first question is the factorial of a number. This is one of the basic and important program that every beginner should learn. So what is a factorial of a number? So it's a concept you would definitely learn if you are a mathematical student, and factorial is nothing but factorial of n is product of all positive descending integers. Hope you have understood this. This is very simple. That is, if you have to find the factorial of 3, it's nothing but 3 into 2 into 1, that is 6. Similarly for 4, 4 into 3 into 2 into 1, that is 24. Similarly for 5, it is 520. So you need to frame a program here. So let's see how we have written the coding for this practice. So as I have told you, we are writing and explaining the logics in Java programming. So we are practicing the competitive coding in a single language so that it would be easy for us. So let's see how we have framed it. So I have written a class and public static main method, which is the structure of Java programming while we write. So in this crucial logic, let's see. So if you want to write programs in other language, you could simply use this logic and you could use the syntax of the programming language and easily build your own program. So let's see. So I have took two variables, that is I and fact, and I have initialized fact with 1. And for real time being, I am declaring my num equal to 5. That means I want to find factorial of 5. So to find factorial of 5, I need to find 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. So that means I would get the factorial. So now for that, I am taking a for loop and iterating my for loop until my iterator becomes I. That is, initializing my iterator I with 1 initially, and I want to check whether my I is less than or equal to I. At first, I would be 1, then fact equal to fact is already 1, fact into I, 1 into 1, 1. Next, I plus plus. So now my I becomes 2, then again enters the loop, fact equal to fact is already 1, 1 into 2, that is 2. Now I becomes 3, now fact is already 2, so 3 into 2, 6. Now I equal to 4. And my fact is already 6, 6 into 4, 24. Now my I becomes 5, that is 24 into 5, that is 120. So in this way, we would be finding factorial of a number. This is very simple. You could also practice. So the next most important program is prime number. So basically, these are not direct questions, but you can use these concepts when you are deriving the logics for complex problems. So most of the problems would definitely use this logic. Like, you need to find the factorial and use somewhere in the program, or you need to find prime number, check prime number and use it somewhere in your logic. So in these ways, these programs will build your logics. So next programming is check prime number. So how do you check the prime number? A number that is greater than 1 and divided by 1 or itself. only called prime number. That means it would have only two factors, 1 and itself. If it has multiple prime factors, then it's not a prime number. So you would know the examples what a prime number is. So 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13 and so on. These were the examples of prime numbers and it would go on. You could observe here 2 is an even prime. So that's basically everyone should know. So let's see how you are going to solve the program for this. So it's a simple program. So here earlier I have directly declared my number equal to 5 instead of taking from user, instead of scanning or taking user input from the keyboard. So now here I'm declaring my scanner to read my input. So I have declared scanner and I'm reading a number and storing it in n. I have also initialized two variables, initial I and flag. Here I am declaring my flag equal to 0 and earlier I have declared flag equal to 1. You could understand here, while doing sum you could declare 0, but while you are multiplying then you should definitely declare 1. Otherwise every time 0 into something would always be 0. Hence the reason while you are performing product your flag variable should be initialized to 1. Okay, so let's see how we are framing a prime number program. So if I give input as 0 or 1, then it should say directly it's not a prime number. If the input is other than 0 and 1, then it would enter the else loop and check our logic. So it need to check from beginning, from 2 to the number, whether our number is divisible by, suppose we have took 5. Now we should check the condition whether 5 is divisible by 2, 5 is divisible by 3, 5 is divisible by 4 and 5 is divisible by 5, right? So in this way we need to check our logic. So I am iterating the for loop and checking whether n mod I equal to 0, then system.out.println n is not a prime number, because we have one more factor. Suppose we are considering 6, then it is divisible by 2 and 3. So there itself, whenever it is divisible by 2, we can directly tell yes, it is not a prime number, because it has one more additional factor. Its prime number should have only two factors, 1 and itself. So if it is divisible by 2, there itself we are making our flag 1. So initially flag 0, that means we are making 1 whenever it is divisible by 1, whenever it is divisible by any other number other than 1 and itself. And we are breaking our for loop and we are coming out of the for loop and we are checking if our earlier it should be flag should be 0 until after the your completion of the for loop also it should remain 0 only. If it has changed, that means somewhere it has satisfied our logic and it has become 1. If here we are checking is flag or 0, no, hence our number is divisible by 1, so 6 is not a prime number. Simple. So you could understand more by writing your own logic. So let's see the next program. So check palindrome. So check palindrome is another important program. So in this you would cover two logics, that is you can find reverse of a number as well as palindrome. So both are interlinked. So palindrome is nothing but first you would be giving a number and you need to find the reverse of that number and check the first number and the reverse of the number are same. Then if it satisfies, then it's a palindrome, otherwise it's not a palindrome. So see the examples of palindrome are 1 to 1, I would reverse it, the same number I would get, so it is a palindrome. 3 to 3, 5 to 5, and there are many other examples. So let's see how we are going to frame the program for this. So I have declared my class and I have imported util.scanner so that I would use my scanner for reading the input. Now I am taking the input and storing it n, and I have initialized a couple of variables, remainder, temp, sum equal to 0, and I would use these variables in our program. And I have initialized n is our input which we are reading from the input, and I'm assigning it to the temp variable so that we are storing it in temp variable, because we are going to modify our n value further in the logic. So now in the while loop we are checking until our number should be greater than 0, until number is greater than 0, this while loop logics keep on working. So what we are doing in the while loop, we are taking the last digit, that is n mod 10 would give the last digit of the number that we are storing in remainder. Now in the sum, we are doing sum is equal to sum into 10 plus r. So r is a typo mistake, it's r nothing but remainder. So why we are doing sum into 10, that's the question over here, right? So first we are at units place, correct? So each time we would be extracting one digit and we are multiplying with 10, so that first time 1 into 10 something, I mean something into 10 would give you a 10 digit, I mean so 1 into 10 would give 10. Next time this sum would be 10, again you would be multiplying into 10, that means it would give 100 places, units, tens, hundreds, thousands. So until how many times you are removing the digit, those many times you would also be multiplying with the 10 to find the number that we need. So sum is equal to sum into 10 plus remainder, whichever we are getting here, and we are adding up here. So each time you are taking a digit means you are first, see, if let us consider 1 to 1 number, first we would extract 1 and we would see sum into 10. So 1 into 10 would be 10, okay. Sum is 0, 0 into 10, 0, okay. 0 plus 1, that is our sum is 1. Next we would extract, what happens, n is equal to n mod 10, that means it would give us the quotient. So our number is 1 to 1, now we will have only 1 2 has the number. Now again it checks, 1 2 is greater than 0, yes it is greater than 0. Again we would get n mod 10, that means 1 12 mod 10 would give us 2. Now we are, our sum is already 1, 1 into 10 is 10 plus what is our remainder, 2. So now 12, now again n mod 10, now our number becomes 1. While n is greater than 0, yes n is greater than 0, hence n is greater than 0, and now n mod 10 would give us 1, 1 mod 10 would give us 1. Now we have in sum 12, now 12 into 10, 12 into 10 would give us 120 plus what is our remainder, 1. So our sum is 121. Now n mod 10 would give you 0. Now your condition won't satisfy, hence n is not greater than 0. Now we are checking. So here until we got the total sum here, now we are checking. Earlier we initialized a temp variable, now we are checking with the sum whether it is greater than or equal, or it, whether our sum is equal to the temp which we have declared. So if it is equal, it is a palindrome, otherwise not a palindrome number. So next program is the Fibonacci series. So Fibonacci series is nothing but the next number in the series will always be the sum of previous two numbers, and the first two numbers of the Fibonacci series are always 0 and 1. So we have an example series here, you can look, have a look at it. That is 0 is the first number, 1 is the second number. Next, 0 plus 1 is 1, again 1 plus 1 is 2. Next, 1 plus 2 is 3. Next, 3 plus 2 is 5. Next, 8 means 5 plus 3, and so on. So in this way, the Fibonacci series. And you need to write a program to print this series. So it's so simple logic. It might look somewhat confusing, but it's so simple. As I have told, first number and second number would be 0 and 1. So I have took two variables and initialized 0 and 1. And I also took a third variable so that to store the next number in the series. And for example, in this program we would find the series of 10 numbers, I mean first 10 Fibonacci series numbers. So until 10 we would be going to find series of those numbers in this program. So first we are directly printing our n value, n1 and n2, that is it won't change, right? So n1 is 0, n2 is 1. Now we need to find the third, fourth, five, six, seven. So now for that we are writing a logic. In the for loop, int I equal to 0, int initializing I should be start from 2, not 0. Why not 0? Because we have print printed, already printed our first number and second number, that is 0 and 1th location is already printed. So we are directly starting from second number. Okay. And I less than the number which we are declared, that is 10. Until I less than 10, it should traverse. I mean, this loop should be keep on working. And each time we are incrementing the I value. So now third number, how we are achieving? Third number is n1 plus n2, that is 1. So we would get third number. Now we are printing our third number, n3. After, as soon as we are printing, what we are doing, we are assigning our n3, n1 value to n2. That means our, now what happens, earlier 0 and 1 were the n1 and n2. Now we found n3 and we have printed n3. Now what we are doing, we are giving n2 value to n1 and n3 value to n2. That means now again when the for loops starts in the next iteration, I would be 3, our next I number n3 equal to n1 and 2. But now in this case we have n1 equal to 1 and n2 equal to 1. So n3 would become 2. So in this way the programming logic would work until our number is 10 and we would find the series of those numbers. So it's so simple. So the next program is the Armstrong number. So what is an Armstrong number? If the sum of the cubes of its digits of the number is equal to the given number, then it is an Armstrong number. That means so simple. If you are given a number, you need to cube each and every digit, and the sum obtained after cubing each digit, if it is equal to the given number, then it's an Armstrong number. So I have took an example, 153. So 153 has 153. So 1 cube plus 5 cube plus 3 cube will be equal to 153. Hence, it is an Armstrong number. So let's see how we are going to frame the logic for this. The next we are has did in the earlier videos also, I am reading the input to scanner and storing it in N. And I have initialized a couple of variables, remainder, sum equal to 0 and temp. Took a temp variable and assigning my reading input to temp, so that we would have the original value, so that we can check in the latter part of our program. Now the same logic, while n is greater than 0, I am doing the same logic whichever I did in the palindrome program. But here, instead of summing with in the sum, what we are doing, the sum is equal to sum plus our remainder whichever we are obtaining. What is our remainder? That is 153. First time we would get 3, that is 3 cube. Next time we would get 5, that is 5 cube. Next time we would get 1, that is 1 cube. Each time we are getting the remainder and summing, finding the cube and adding it to the already existing sum. Okay, so after adding and all, after iterating to all the digits, our n, and we would come from the while loop, then we would check. We have the original value in the temp variable, that is our n which we have read from the input would be available in temp, and we would be checking with the temp whether temp, if temp is equal to the sum which we obtained, if it is equal, then it's Armstrong number, otherwise it's not an Armstrong number. So simple. So thanks for watching this video and hope you have liked this video. And if you want to learn more coding problems, you could check out our problem. I will attach a card over here. The most important coding problems you could learn regularly step by step. So that's it for this video. Thank you. Bye bye.